Hello and greetings, you beautiful human beings. I would like to begin today by giving a special shout out to the young men of M and Messiah, the M and Messiah small group, who have written me a letter, exquisite letter, which has both enriched my mind and my heart. Much love to you, young men of M and Messiah, for a real letter. Touching. Thank you. And thank all of you for being here today. Let's dive right in. I recently read some statistics on Gen Z. Not exactly. Gen Z, that's you. And it's about the church. It's about your faith. And here's what I read. Three numbers. 35%, a little over a third of you, of youth in the U.S. believe that church is irrelevant and hypocritical. 60% of young people who grow up in Christian churches end up walking away from their faith. 6 out of 10. And the third number is 75% of U.S. Christian teens read the Bible only once a month or less. In other words, according to these numbers, your generation is walking further and further away from God. But I'm wondering if you are the ones who are going to change those numbers, who are going to change those numbers by committing more deeply to your faith and instead of walking away, actually inviting more people in. Listen, on your own, this is impossible. But with the power of God, all things are possible. See, your efforts combined with God's power can and will change the world. I said, your efforts combined with God's power can and will change the world. I said, your efforts combined with God's power can and will change the world. In order to live with this kind of power from God, you need, and I need, we need a deep level of what? I wonder what came to your mind. I'm going to come back to this. Hold on to that. But first, I'd like to tell you a story. A story about a boy named Brennan. You know, a story like this really needs some background music. Can we have a little music? That's nice, but it's a little movie trailer-like. Maybe something a little more reflective, a little more thoughtful. Oh yeah, that's nice. Brennan was a young boy, and he wanted what most children want. What really most all of us want, and that was to know that he was loved. But he had his doubts. See, his father wasn't home very much, not because he didn't care, but because he was always looking for work. Work was difficult to come by in those days. So his father wasn't home much. His mother, instead of hugging him and holding him and kissing him, his mother most often told him he was a nuisance, and she often told him to shut up. He heard that a number of times every day. His mother was orphaned at the age of 3, and because of her childhood, was not well equipped to show love to Brennan. And one day when his father came home, his mother was in a bad mood, and she started talking to the father about the older brother and said, "This boy has been impossible all day. I want you to take him right now, march him to the police station, ask them to throw him in jail, and leave him there." Brennan's brother was 8. Brennan was 6 at the time. Shockingly, Brennan's dad said, "Okay," and he took the brother and they left. They walked out the front door. Brennan ran to the window and put his face against the glass and watched them walk down the sidewalk. He was terrified. All he wanted was to see his brother walk back to the house. And he waited and waited and waited. It was 30 minutes, which isn't that long, but to him it seemed like an eternity. And after 30 minutes, He finally saw his dad walking back toward the house, alone. His brother wasn't with him. In that moment, Brennan knew he was unprotected. He was utterly alone in the world. He was unloved, unwanted, and he knew that he would be next. I want to tell you another story about a different son. This son was 18, and he had a great family, loving parents, and for whatever reason, he went to his father one day and said, "Dad, you know how when you die, you're going to give me an inheritance? To me and my brother, you're going to give us an inheritance. I was just wondering, Dad, could I have mine now? I'd like it now." And amazingly, the dad said yes, and the dad gave him his inheritance, and he took it and he left. He left home. He went to Vegas, and he burned through the money quickly, to the point that he had nothing left. He was homeless, he was hungry, and so he got a job washing dishes at a greasy diner. One night, as he was scraping food off of customers' plates, he was longing to eat the food. He was hungry. And as he stared at the food that fell in the trash can, an idea came to him. He started to think about the old days when he was back home and the incredible meals his family shared together, and he thought, "What if I go home? I know that I don't deserve to be a son, but what if I go and ask my dad if I can work for him? My dad runs a business, he has a lot of employees, and he knows I'm a good worker." And then, as he was staring into the trash can thinking about this, he snapped out of it when his boss leaned into the kitchen and said, "Get back to work!" He hated his boss. He hated his life. That night, he was thinking about this idea. And I want you to wonder with me, what did he do? Did he stay in Vegas and continue washing dishes, or did he go back home? Those of you familiar with the parables of Jesus know that this was a retelling of a story Jesus told in Luke 15 called the parable of the prodigal son. As the son was pondering whether or not he should go back to his dad, he was planning what he would say to him. And here's one thing he was planning to say. It's found in Luke 15:19. "Dad, I am no longer worthy to be called your son." Of course, biologically, he was still his father's son, but he felt no longer worthy of his father's love. I wonder if 6-year-old Brennan felt the same way, no longer worthy of his parents' love as he watched his father walk home alone, imagining his brother in a jail cell. And then he saw his brother walking 30 yards behind his dad. His brother was coming home. And although he was relieved, Brennan was traumatized by this experience. It really impacted him, and for years, he felt unworthy of being loved. I wonder if we ever feel this way, if we ever feel unworthy of being loved by God. Now, I think intellectually we know God loves everyone. God is love, the Bible says. But I wonder if we always feel that way. Maybe you've thought things like, you know, because of what I've done, because of that mistake I made, because of that sin I committed in my past, I don't think God could really love me. Or maybe because of the thing that you're doing right now, that sin you're struggling with and you keep struggling with, you think, I sort of know God loves me, but I don't really feel it. Like, I don't really feel like God could love me. Or maybe you have thoughts like this. You know, how could God love me when I don't even love him back? I don't even pay attention to him. I don't read the Bible. I don't pray that much. You know, I don't worship. I don't go to church. How could God really, like, does he really love me? Let me tell you about the end of Jesus' parable. The son does decide to return to his father. And it says that when he was still a long way off, he was still on the road, he didn't even arrive on the property yet, the father saw the son and ran to him. The father was watching and waiting, not because the son sent him a text and said, "Dad, I'm coming home," but because I believe the father had been waiting and watching ever since the son left, because his love was huge for his son. And he ran up and he ran into his son and embraced him and hugged him, said, "Son, you're home, I'm so thankful you're home. I don't care what you've done. I'm so thankful you're back. You're my son, and I love you let's throw a party. And he threw a party. They had a big celebration, a big family celebration, because his son who was lost was home. He's been found. Jesus told that parable to convince people back then that he was speaking to, and to convince us and everyone in between, that God loves us. One of my favorite quotes says this: there's nothing we can do to increase God's love for us, and there's nothing we can do to decrease it. In other words, there's nothing we can do to make God love us more, and there's nothing we can do to make God love us less. God's love is powerful. It's unconditional. Guess who wrote that quote? Brennan Manning. Brennan Manning, the same Brennan who is a six-year-old boy looking out the window wondering if his brother would ever come home. The same Brennan who years later was in western Pennsylvania in the Allegheny Mountains near Pittsburgh. And in his words, he was ambushed by Jesus. God changed his life. He opened himself up in a whole new way to trust that God does love him, and that changed everything inside of him. Brennan Manning, who has written over 20 books, who have helped millions of people around the world in their faith, me included. I've read a number of his books and have been really blessed and impacted by them. Brennan Manning, who has spoken all around the world, connecting people more deeply with the love of God. Earlier in this message, I said that in order to receive that kind of empowering from God, where we can and will change the world, we need a deep level of, I don't know what word came to your mind, but the word I'm thinking of is trust. We need a deep level of trust. Trust in the fact that God loves you. Do you trust that God loves you? That regardless of what you've done or where you've been or who you are, that God loves you. Do you trust that God loves you? That's where it begins. We love God because he first loved us. In other words, we are capable of loving God because we realize and trust in the fact that he already loves us. To live in God's power, we need to trust in God's love. And let me give you an example of how this impacts people, how it can free people. So Brennan Manning, years later, was praying one morning, and God gave him a vision of his mom as a child with her face against the window, looking out, longing for, praying for two nice people to come and adopt her. In that moment, when God gave Brennan that vision of his mom, he began to weep and sob. And all these years of bitterness and resentment towards his mom melted away. And he wept and he asked forgiveness for holding all of this bitterness towards his mom. And he felt God's forgiveness, and he felt his mom's forgiveness. And he forgave his mom. And he said, that was a turning point for me as God was continuing to heal me. Because he trusted in God's love enough, God gave him that vision of his mom and healed his heart. And Brennan was then more free and more empowered and more equipped to go and help others. I want to challenge you to trust that God loves you. And then to find your purpose in him. The trust comes first, I believe. Unless we trust that God loves us, it's going to be difficult to find our purpose in him. Tonight, you're going to read two verses that Paul wrote, one from Galatians, one from Ephesians. And as you read these, I hope that God will remind you of how valuable you are to him and how much he wants to do in and through your life. Because again, I believe that your efforts combined with God's power can and will change the world. God, I thank you for everyone who's listening and watching this. I thank you for these small groups. I pray a blessing on them. I pray that you would open up the doors of conversation tonight. Open up hearts and minds ever wider to your love. And I pray that you would do a work in these groups, a work in every individual that would empower them to change the world. We love you in Jesus' name. Amen. Thanks for watching this. Thanks for being in your groups. I wonder who needs an invitation. Who's not in your group right now who needs to be there? Maybe you could be the one to invite them. I love you all. Take care.